Okay, the final item of business is a member's debate on motion 1071 in the name of Maggie Chapman on a just transition for Torry. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Would those members who wish to speak in this debate please press the request to speak buttons now or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Maggie Chapman to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank Mercedes Villalba, Audrey Nicholl and the other MSPs who supported this motion. I am very pleased to have lodged this motion today, not just because this is my first ever Members' Motion and the first Scottish Greens Members' Business Session of the Parliament, but because I think it highlights so much of what we need to consider as we design and build a better, fairer, greener world. The campaign to save St Fitticks Park and Dooney's Farm speaks to fundamental issues of power and democracy. It speaks to issues of inequality and deprivation. It speaks to challenges to the status quo, to business as usual, and to the neoliberal economic model that have created both the climate emergency and the nature emergency. In short, it speaks to the inextricable links between social, economic, and environmental justice, and it is this interconnected understanding of what justice is that must be at the heart of a just transition for Torry, for the North East, and for Scotland. St Fitticks Community Park, for those who don't know it, is an award-winning wetland and reed beds in the south of Aberdeen. The brainchild of SEPA as a way of making space for biodiversity and supporting local people, the park is a relatively small urban green space in Torry. The community neighbouring the park is one of the 10 most deprived in Scotland, with a life expectancy 12 years lower than elsewhere in Aberdeen. Squished between industrial land and a sewage works, the park is the only accessible green space for this community. It is well loved and well used by people who live locally, mostly in tower blocks and flats. Dooney's Farm, or Dooney's Rare Breeds Farm, to give it its full name, is just a bit further down the coast road from St Fitticks. It is nationally recognised, having one of Scotland's largest collections of rare and endangered farm animal breeds. It is a favourite place for family days out, where children and young people can learn about farming, about different animals, and so much more. Together, these two sites are the lungs of Torry. In stark contrast to the greyness of the heavy industry around them, including the current harbour development at Nigg Bay, St Fitticks Park and Dooney's Farm are vibrant, varied places with a range of habitats, species, facilities and amenities for all to enjoy. St Fitticks has what you might expect from a community park: play areas for children, a skate park, accessible paths for walking, wheeling and cycling. But, and this is what makes it so special, it also boasts areas of woodland, wet meadow, reed bed, and diverse dry grasslands. And then there's the staggering biodiversity. Over 40 species of breeding birds, including 9 red list species and 8 amber list ones. Over 115 plant species, including a wonderful array of orchids, and hundreds of invertebrates, many of which are still being documented. And as well as the great variety of dogs that have regular walks in the park, otters, deer, and other mammals can be spotted in the reeds and woods. As we come into autumn, we'll start to see some of the tens of thousands of migratory birds who stop over at these green spaces. Over winter, we'll see a substantial snipe population. All the work done a decade ago by the Aberdeen Ranger Service and SEPA have really paid off. What was a polluted, poor quality and inaccessible area is now an award-winning biodiverse wetland, which just last year won the Biodiversity and Climate Change category in the RSPB's Nature Scot Awards. There really isn't anywhere else like it in the city of Aberdeen. Why are we even contemplating destroying it? Because that's exactly what's happening. Aberdeen City Council has proposed rezoning these areas as opportunity sites for industrial development in the city's new local development plan. Specifically, there are proposals for an energy transition zone, or ETZ, to be sited on this urban green space and greenbelt land. Their proximity to the South Harbour development at NIG, the sewage works and other encircling industrial estates mean that developers like ETZ Limited want to use this land for industrial purposes, and that appears to be the settled will of the Council too. I want to be very clear. My opposition to the rezoning and development of both St Fittick's Community Park and Dooney's Farm in no way diminishes my passionate support for energy transition. I and everyone I know campaigning to save St Fittick's Park and Dooney's Farm are only too well aware of the need for an energy transition. Torry has suffered, as other communities have, as the oil and gas industry has declined. We get that the climate emergency is affecting people and nature all over the world. But we also know that we can get the energy transition we need without destroying valuable community green space. Other sites, brownfield sites, are available, other options possible. We must not concrete over the lungs of the community. This would result in poor air quality, pollution and noise, not to mention the loss of amenity and valuable nature. We know we face a climate emergency. We know we also face a nature emergency. This motion and the community campaign are very clear that urgent action is needed. But we cannot tackle the climate emergency by compromising the health and well-being of biodiverse habitats, never mind the health and well-being of communities, some who live within metres of proposed industry. That would be directly affected. We understand that climate justice cannot happen without environmental and social justice. Destroying nature cannot be the cornerstone of the energy transition we so desperately need. So we must encourage plans for the development of wind turbine manufacture, for a wind turbine parts assembly area, and for decommissioning. But this work, and it is vital because of the jobs that come with it, but this work must be developed on sites that are not green space or green belt. There are brownfield sites available at East Tullis and Alton's, less than a kilometre away. And with rail and road access, I'll give way.
Douglas Lumsden.
Yes, thank you for giving way. You mentioned there's other brownfield sites nearby. When we talk about the energy transition zone, we're often talking about large wind turbines. Do you think it would be feasible for them to be transported to other sites that are maybe like half a mile away from the harbour?
Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much for that point of order. Yes, absolutely. As I've just mentioned, the sites that are possible at East Tullis and Alton's are on good road and a rail link, less than a kilometre away. Such brownfield site development will also have lower carbon emissions than ripping up wetlands, because we know wetlands act as carbon sinks. And vitally, communities should be involved in the decisions about the siting of this kind of development. Their voices have not been heard up until now. That must change. Because if we are serious about a just transition underpinning Scotland's future, we need to not only recognise the connections between environmental, social and economic justice, but we must act accordingly. So I ask the Scottish Government to listen to the people of Torry, listen to the experts at Scottish Wildlife Trust who support the aims of the campaign, and make any Scottish Government support for the energy transition zone conditional on both the use of brownfield sites and genuine community engagement. Because only then can we deliver a genuinely just transition for Torry. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. We now move to the open debate. I call Audrey Nicol, who will be followed by Mercedes Villalba. Ms Nicol, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I thank Maggie Chapman for bringing this motion today, and I draw members' attention to my register of interests. I am a councillor for the Torry Ferry Hill ward in Aberdeen, within which St Fittick's Park is located. It's also in my constituency. And I put on my record my support for a just transition. We're at a point of urgency in climate change. St Fittick's Park, as Maggie Chapman described, is like the mothership of Torry. Generations of families have gone there to play, exercise, just hit the reset button. It hosts cultural heritage and supports carbon sequestration and flood control. An important local asset, restored and valued by the community. It is bounded by a harbour under construction, a wastewater plant and an energy from waste plant under construction, so it is a precious green space to many. In February 2020, St Fitticks found itself included in the draft Aberdeen City Local Development Plan just weeks before approval as an area supporting energy transition. I put on record I supported an amendment proposing the sites be removed from the LDP and alternative sites found. This was defeated at vote. Hundreds of emails followed, literally hundreds. Didn't I realise this was the last green space in Torry? Where are we supposed to go now? What is an ETZ? Friends of St Fitticks and others have made a powerful case to save the park, and I pay particular tribute to Dr Ishbel Shand, Leslie Ann Mulholland, Ian Baird and others in their campaigning efforts. Media coverage created some confusion. The project was described as shovel-ready, yet other coverage quoted local politicians reassuring the community just because it's part of the local development plan doesn't mean it will happen. And the LDP is not the end of the line for the Torry Green Space campaign. So which was it? Where are we now with St Fitticks Park? The proposed development plan currently sits with the independent reporter, and it will be for Aberdeen City Council to consider any forthcoming planning application. But in the meantime, there is a wider context to this issue. The North East is rightly positioning itself as a centre for energy transition. However, to date, the debate on energy transition has derived from an industry context. Professor Tavis Potts, Interim Director of the Centre for Energy Transition at the University of Aberdeen, highlights that there is now a need for a community-orientated perspective where areas are developed in a consensual way, meeting both community and industry needs. In a Torry context, Professor Potts observes his research has uncovered a strong feeling of dispossession in Torry, that the community has had development imposed on it. The Scottish Government response to the Net Zero Nation Engagement Strategy identified participation should be inclusive and reflective of all parts of society and not tokenistic. Presiding Officer, an ETZ is an important economic opportunity for diversification from fossil fuels and could have real value for the workforce in Aberdeen. However, it must be underpinned by broader just transition policy principles where communities such as Torry are genuine partners and derive real and meaningful benefit. I welcome the commitment of ETZ Limited to community engagement and constructive dialogue, and I very much hope that all the decision makers involved in the project embrace the principles of strong partnership, not just consultation, community wealth building and creative approaches that genuinely benefit the people of Torry. To conclude, Presiding Officer, there are options available in this regard. However, there is only one St Fitticks Park. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Nicol. I now call on Mercedes Villalba, who will be followed by Liam Kerr. Ms Villalba, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you. Before I start, I'd just like to thank Maggie Chapman for inviting me to second the motion. And I'd just like to say that I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak on this issue in the Chamber. So this summer I visited Torry, where I met with campaigners from the Friends of St Fitticks Park. And as Audrey and Maggie have already said, they should be commended for fighting to protect a community green space for all residents of Torry. As has already been said, it's a well-loved and well-used space. And I find Aberdeen City Council's decision to rezone both St Fitticks Park and Dooney's Rare Breeds Farm as opportunity sites for industrial development to be clearly short-sighted. As has been said, St Fitticks Park is an award-winning biodiverse area of woodland, wetland and recreational grassland, and it's also currently designated as urban green space. And Dooney's Farm is a key conservation site which houses 23 rare breeds. And the COVID-19 pandemic has surely demonstrated the value of such assets to our communities. They're vital for mental and community well-being, and they ensure that local people can exercise their right to a healthy environment. The Energy Transition Zone project brings with it the risks of over-industrialisation for Torry, which can lead to poor air quality, and it can also create various forms of pollution, like noise pollution. And it can lead to the loss of green space, leading to severe environmental and community well-being consequences. So with all of this in mind, it's unsurprising that Torry residents and campaign groups such as the Scottish Wildlife Trust are opposed to the ETZ project. But local opposition to the ETZ isn't purely motivated by these environmental and community well-being concerns. Torry residents and campaigners are rightly frustrated by the lack of meaningful consultation. And the Scottish Government on this issue says it's for Aberdeen City Council and the developers, ETZ Limited, to engage with the community. And Aberdeen City Council and ETZ Limited say that a statutory consultation will be driven by the Scottish Government. This game of shifting responsibility is unacceptable. The people of Torry should have been proactively engaged with from the start of the ETZ project. Residents feel the lack of meaningful engagement reinforces their concerns that the decision has already been made to proceed with the project. And the Scottish Government seems unwilling to engage with the concerns of residents. So I asked the Cabinet Secretary to outline how the proposed site for the ETZ was chosen, given the significant public investment that the project is receiving. And he was quick to pass responsibility on to Aberdeen City Council and the developers. And when I pushed him on what the benefits would be for the people of Torry, he said that ETZ should offer benefits, such as providing open space for residents and improving biodiversity. But I don't think any Torry resident or campaigner believes that the ETZ can deliver these benefits. It's important to note that nobody who's opposed to the ETZ project is refusing to recognise the need for us to transition away from fossil fuels. But we shouldn't do that by sacrificing existing biodiverse green spaces with strong community support like St Fittick's Park and Dooney's Farm. These two sites are of great value to the local community and really worthy of protection, which is why I supported the motion and I urge all members to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Villalba. And I now call on Liam Kerr. Again, 4 minutes, please, Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to speak in this debate. As having lived in Aberdeen, in central Aberdeen, for nearly 2 decades now, I'm very aware of the area and the facilities. I've also spent many afternoons at Dooney's with my family and readily acknowledge the importance of these to the local and wider community. The motion also rightly mentions the importance of our transition from fossil fuels, something which in this afternoon's debate, speaker after speaker recognised, which is why I'm particularly pleased that ETZ Limited, the not-for-profit business that was launched earlier this year to focus on this transition zone, has as its core aim to economically reposition the North East by reducing its reliance on oil and gas. So there is a delicate balancing act, and the local community and Friends of St Fittick's Park are to be commended, as Mercedes Villalba said, for standing up to be counted when their green space and facilities appear to be threatened. And I believe that in the earlier local development plan consultation stage, a great many people submitted representations to the council. Now, that having been done, there will be a formalisation of a proposal for an energy transition zone. Just last week, what is described as a multiple award-winning environmental consultancy, Ironside Farrar, was engaged to lead the work on a master plan for the energy transition zone. And only once they have drawn up detailed proposals will there be an application for planning permission in principle. Now, I hope the community are encouraged by that, because I understand that bids for the master plan contract that the Ironside Farrar won were evaluated on the basis of 70% quality and only 30% cost. And I understand that they are backed by a Queen's Award for Enterprise for sustainable development. They've also apparently won awards for environmental improvements in Fittey and Kincard and O'Neill. So, yes.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank Liam Kerr for taking an intervention. Will he not agree with me, however great this master plan might be, it still represents a loss of greenbelt land and a loss of urban green space if developed at all?
Liam Kerr.
Well, potentially, yes, and that's exactly the point why I think I am encouraged that the very people who are being appointed to assess this and to build the master plan have this pedigree. Because perhaps most importantly, according to ETZ Limited, Ironside Farrer will, quote, play a key role in engaging with the local community and other stakeholders through the various stages of the master planning process. Now, Neil Hanforth, ETZ's development and infrastructure developer, says that Ironsides, quote, have a proven track record of finding creative and sustainable solutions and prioritising community participation as a key element of project delivery. He goes on to say that critical to the project's success is ensuring that the local community is listened to throughout the process. And I think that is hugely encouraging, that the very people who intend to make the proposals recognise how important it is to listen to the community. Hanforth has also committed to explore with the community ideas around a number of specific projects and initiatives that would have the aim of developing local amenities, whilst also paying heed to the importance of local biodiverse areas. Now, coupled with all of that, Aberdeen City Council is on the record as recognising the climate and biodiverse city emergencies. They were one of the first local authorities to sign the Edinburgh Biodiversity Declaration, committing their support for local action on conservation of biodiversity. The aim is to send a strong message that supporting local action is key to protecting the natural environment on which, as you've rightly pointed out, as members pointed out, we all depend. It should further be recognised that the natural environment is one of the six themes in the citywide net zero plan that the city is developing. Presiding Officer, it is perfectly understandable that the community is concerned. We all understand that. But this whole process is at a very early stage, and I believe it could be around a year before the master plan is to come together. Safeguards for the environmental, biodiversity and community protections appear to be in place, and I look forward to seeing how these plans develop.
Thank you very much, Mr Kerr. I now call on Richard Lockhead to respond to the debate. Minister, for around 7 minutes, please.
Can I start by thanking Maggie Chapman for bringing this debate to the Chamber today and congratulate her on securing our first Members' debate in Parliament. I'm sure all of us who have served as members of this Parliament for some time have experienced lots of cases like this in our own areas where the interests of communities and planned developments can at times appear to come into conflict with each other. And it's part of our duty as parliamentarians to highlight such local campaigns, give them a national platform. So again, I think this is an important debate to have in this Parliament. I will address the question of the development of the energy transition zone shortly, but first I really want to set out what I do see as a context for this debate and highlight some aspects of the members' motions which I agree with and I'm sure we all agree with. Firstly, it's important to recognise that Scotland has already undergone and started what is an impressive energy transition over the past decade, which we could all see, I guess, is the first phase of the energy transition we have to go through. For instance, emissions from our electricity system have reduced by over 70% since 1990, and that is a world-leading achievement that we can all be proud of, but we do know there's still much more to do if we are to end our reliance on fossil fuels in the decades ahead, as the motion tabled by the member notes. There's lots of other things happening. To give one example, which is very relevant to this debate, our offshore wind policy statement sets out the ambition of developing between 8 and 11 gigawatts new offshore generation capacity by 2030. And I'm sure we all appreciate how vital that is that we continue our energy transition if we are to meet our climate change targets and avoid the damaging consequences of the climate emergency. And there is absolutely no doubt in my mind, and this gets to the heart of this debate again, that Aberdeen and the northeast of Scotland can lead this transition. The components are there. We have a skilled workforce, a vibrant private sector, and infrastructure that can be repurposed to drive our transition to net zero. We've got all the ingredients for Aberdeen and Scotland to show global leadership when it comes to the energy transition and indeed the just transition as well. With this context, the backdrop for the debate, I also want to say a few words in support of the aspects of the member's motion that I again wholeheartedly agree with in terms of the importance of delivering a just transition. That's why we were the first country in the world to enshrine in law our commitment to the principles of just transition. It's both the outcome we want to see, a fairer, greener future for everyone in Scotland, but also the process that must be undertaken in partnership with those most impacted by the transition to net zero. It is about how we get to a net zero and climate resilient economy in a way that also delivers fairness and tackles inequality and injustice. It's essential this process is co-designed and co-delivered. And I can point to lots of examples of where we are putting this into practice. But our groundbreaking Just Transition Commission was set up to engage people widely through the transition and travelled the country for over 2 years listening to communities that will be affected by net zero transition. Indeed, just to put on record, that earlier today I announced a new commission will be formed, and with Professor Jim Ski remaining as chair, who was chair of the previous Just Transition Commission. And I expect the new group will continue to engage broadly through the course of their
Minister,
work.
Point of order, Liam Kerr.
The Minister's... I'm actually quite enjoying the Minister's speech, but I'm not sure... Maggie Chapman has brought a very relevant motion to the Chamber, and with respect, I'm not sure that the Minister is directly addressing some of the key points that have been made by Ms Chapman.
Thank you very much, Mr Kerr. I've been listening to the Minister's contribution. It has spanned more broadly, but that's not unheard of for Ministers. I would encourage the Minister to make sure that he does address the motion. But as I say, I don't think this is necessarily out of order, but thank you, Mr Kerr. Minister.
With all due respect to the member, I've got the motion in front of me, and there are many references to the points that I've just made in my opening remarks about the context of this debate and the just transition and the factors we have to take into account as we go on this journey and the impact it has on communities over the coming decades. The motion also asks we recognise the importance of green space for communities and the importance of tackling the biodiversity crisis. Again, that's something we agree with the member on. And the impact of COVID, as some members have highlighted, has had on all of us, again, has led to a renewed appreciation of green space. As we move towards recovery, the healing and restorative power of nature should not be forgotten. Again, that's the message of our statement of intent for biodiversity, which recognises the increasing urgency of tackling the challenge of biodiversity loss. But in terms of the proposed site of the energy transition zone in Torry, I am grateful again, to the member for bringing this debate to our attention. Of course, it has to be stressed that it's inappropriate for ministers to comment on the specific case at this stage. But as Minister for Just Transition, I think there are many powerful points made during the debate that I would want to reflect upon as we move forward, because we are at an early stage of developing the Just Transition in Scotland. It's something that's going to be here with us for decades. And there are some balances that have to be sorted that we should reflect upon. Yep.
Maggie Chapman.
Thank you very much for taking the intervention, Minister. Could I invite you to visit St Fittick's Community Park and Dooney's Rowbreeds Farm at some point as in your ministerial role to have a look and see exactly what the community of Torry is at risk of losing here?
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I'm assuming you were extending the invitation to the Minister rather than myself as presiding officer. But I
was indeed, although you would be very welcome too.
I am very grateful,
Minister.
Officer,
you're most welcome to join me on that visit. I was going to mention that I would look forward to having the opportunity to actually visit the site at some point in the future as well. I know the local member would also like me to do that as well. I understand that there's a clan lighthouse at the Torry Battery, not too far away, which my wife is desperate to see. So I am keen to visit at some point. But obviously, the just transition issues are very, very important in that regard. So I will certainly reflect on the timing of a visit soon. But the Scottish Government and the Planning Authority both have statutory roles, and any proposals have to, of course, follow due process. So whilst I can't obviously give a direct view on the planning issue, I do want to say that our national planning policy is under currently review, and the energy transition zone was received as one of approximately 250 suggested national developments, and we're all considering now what the suggested national developments should be going forward, with a view to laying a draft national planning framework number 4 in the Scottish Parliament in the autumn. So again, I just want to reiterate, I think there's very important messages today and important issues raised about some of the balances we have to achieve with the just transition. You know, there are planning policies in place at the moment that have to take into account green spaces and biodiversity and make sure that, you know, we are consulting local communities about that. And of course, I would expect all of that to be followed by the local planning authority in terms of taking into account any application. So I just want to thank the member for bringing this to the attention of the Parliament, highlighting the concerns of the local community regarding it. I do recognise many of the points that have been made in relation to a just transition, biodiversity loss and the importance of green space. I will reflect on all of that, even though that's a separate issue than the direct planning application we're discussing today. And I'm sure there'll be many more issues like this as we go forward to make sure that we go through a productive, fruitful energy transition that helps Scotland play a leading role in the world's efforts to tackle the climate emergency.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.